This video is the first part of a short series on the cylindrical capacitor. And in this part, we want to find the electric field between the inner and outer shells of the capacitor. In the second and third videos, we'll compute the capacitance per unit length and the energy per unit length, respectively. So in the problem, we're told we have a cylindrical capacitor made from two long concentric conducting shells. The inner shell has a radius A and a linear charge density of plus lambda. Remember that the units of charge density would be coulombs per meter. And the outer shell has a radius B and a linear charge density of negative lambda. And we want to compute the electric field everywhere. So first I want to note that the point of making the shells very long is that it gives us a nice symmetric electric field. That's the assumption that guarantees the electric field will point outward radially. And to figure out the electric field between the shells, we're going to choose a Gaussian surface. And that's a concentric cylinder whose curved surface lies between the inner and outer shells. And we call the radius of the Gaussian surface R and the length capital L. Note that inside the smaller cylinder, inside of a radius A, so when R is less than A, if we put a Gaussian surface inside that inner shell, it wouldn't contain any charge in it, so we're guaranteed to have a zero electric field. So we're not really interested in that part. And if we chose a Gaussian surface outside the radius B, that would also not contain any charge. So when R is greater than B, we would get E is equal to zero again. And that's because it would have equal parts, positive and negative charge inside of it. So those would cancel out, giving us a net zero charge inside that Gaussian surface. So the area of interest here is when R is between A and B. And that's why the only Gaussian surface I showed is in that region. So it's time to invoke Gauss's law. And Gauss's law says that the electric flux integral through this Gaussian surface is the integral over the entire surface of E dotted into dA. Remember, the direction of an area vector is normal to the surface at any point. So that's what we're thinking of in the dot product. And that's going to be equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon zero. And I'll post a link real quick to the video where Gauss's law was first derived. So because E is perfectly radially outward, that makes it parallel to the end caps of the Gaussian surface. In other words, perpendicular to the area vector. And so those end caps are going to contribute nothing to the total electric flux through this surface. This allows us to say that our flux integral reduces to just the integral over the curved part of our Gaussian surface of E dotted into dA. But E is parallel to the area vector along that entire curved surface. And that means the dot product is trivial and the dot product just turns into the ordinary product. So our flux integral turns into E times dA over the curved part. I'll just call that CP. Next, we realize that the electric field is constant over that entire curved part because at every point you're an equal distance from that inner charged cylinder. And a constant can be factored out of the integral. So I end up with E times the integral of dA over the curved part. But the integral of dA over the curved part is simply the area of the curved part. So we imagine cutting that curved surface and unrolling it. One side of it is going to have a length of 2 pi r, that's the circumference of the cylinder, and the other side has a length of capital L. So we end up with E times the area of the curved part, which is just 2 pi r times L. So that's the result of the flux integral, but we still have to go back and set it equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon zero. So on the left side, I have E times the area of this curved surface, 2 pi r L. On the right side, I have Q enclosed. And to get the charge enclosed within our Gaussian surface, we have to take the linear charge density that's measured in coulombs per meter and multiply by the length measured in meters. In other words, Q enclosed is simply lambda times L. Now our L's are going to cancel out, so the length of our Gaussian surface doesn't matter, and we divide by 2 pi r. And so for this region between the two shells of the cylindrical capacitor, we end up with an electric field of lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0 r. In the next video in this little series, we compute the capacitance of the cylindrical capacitor, and you can link to that video at the upper left side of the end screen, and I'll see you there.